He briefly worked for President Trump, and now he says Trump's supporters are a cult. Anthony Scaramucci is here with me for a chat about all of that and much more. Thanks for coming on.
Good morning. Wasn't that brief, by the way? I mean, it was 11 days in the White House, but it was about 9 months during the campaign and the transition.
That's true. You were working at Fox as a commentator, as a host, and then you had to sever that relationship to go over to the transition team.
I was hosting Wall Street Week, and so when I was announced on the transition team, I had to pull the hosting job from that.
How much has Fox News changed, do you think, in the Trump years?
I don't necessarily think that it's changed. I think that there's certain news commentators on Fox that have made a decision that they're in the tank for the president. And so whatever he's doing, they have sort of like the Fox News kaleidoscope. They'll shift this kaleidoscope to sort of make the colors paint in a way that makes the president look well. And so a couple of commentators have decided to do that. And, you know, what are you going to do? There's other commentators. Shepard Smith, as you know, left the channel. Judge Napolitano, I think they've been a little bit more balanced, a little bit more objective. But I think there's elements of a business model there, Brian, where they're galvanizing a lot of viewers. Your last panel really did describe it. The president's always felt like an outsider. And so when you're an outsider, you're susceptible to conspiracy theories. And it's one of the main reasons why he brought somebody in like Mayor Giuliani to sort of run that shadow system, because he always felt like he was outside of the system. And I think that's where a lot of the problems have come in for the president.
And when you say that Trump supporters belong to a cult, and maybe some of those Fox commentators then belong to the cult, what's your evidence? Why say a word like that?
Well, okay, so if you go to my Twitter feed, I put out the 10 things that you could look at to see if you yourself are in a cult, okay? And what are those 10 things? Someone's blatantly lying to you, and you're accepting those lies as truth. Number two, they're suggesting that they're the only person that is telling the truth. Everyone else, Brian Stelter is an example, all of CNN, MSNBC, they're all telling lies, but the cult leader himself is telling the truth. Third thing, and I think this is the most important thing, you're disaffected. There's a disaffection. The president did capitalize on that. And I actually wrote in my book, The Blue-Collar President, that there is a vacuum of advocacy for white blue-collar workers over the last three decades. And that was malpractice by both establishment Republicans and establishment Democrats. And so he exploited that. And this is the reason why, even though his policies have failed those people, he still represents an avatar for their anger. And so they're going to stick with him until the spell breaks.
You have predicted, though, that the president's not going to last much longer, that he's going to resign or
there's an overwhelming cascade of evidence. And so this week will be the starting of that waterfall. It's one thing when things are behind closed doors and you're doing an investigation. It's another thing when it's open theater and you can actually see the rank lawlessness of what's gone on and the lack of constitutionality in the process with the president. And I think it's not just a Ukrainian call. There will be other elements of this story that unfold where people will say, okay, wait a minute. There's a combination of incompetence. There's a combination of a destruction of the executive branch of the United States, in addition to the lawlessness and traitorous-like behavior. So
traitorous-like behavior?
Oh, there's no question. I mean,
word, Anthony.
Well, what word would you use? You're on the phone with the president of the Ukraine, and you're strong-arming him to have him go after your political opponent. Okay, that is, you're become a traitor to the Constitution and a traitor to the laws of the United States. So do you want to pretend that it's not traitorous behavior? We could pretend that it isn't, and we can continue to gaslight. I think one of the big problems that the American people have in this situation is we have such respect for the American presidency and the institution of that presidency. The man in that office right now is the successor to Abraham Lincoln, George Washington. And so we have a tendency to normalize something that is very abnormal. And so as he continues to gaslight, we have to call him into account for what is actually going on. This is full-blown traitorous activity. And once it gets exposed, then it'll be up to the American people. What I'm shocked by as we sit here today, a couple of days after Election Day, I am shocked that Republican leadership have not disavowed this person. I'm just shocked that they would put their partisan interests and their self-preservation to stay in power over the law and the system of the United States that has led to such prosperity and such freedom for so many people.
You're talking about Mitch McConnell. You're talking about GOP leaders.
Yeah, GOP leaders. You're going to have a person above the law now. This will be the first time in 243 years where there's a group of politicians inside that are saying, you know what, we're going to allow this one person to be above the law. Every other person's been subordinate to the law for the last 243 years, which has led to this great system of liberty and this great system of prosperity. But in order for us to stay in power, somebody's clearly broken the law, clearly doing dishonest things, very un-American things, I might add. You know, forget about the bullying and all the style points. I'm just talking about the illegality, Brian, that if they're going to allow that to take place, I think it's going to be very dangerous for the country.
Well, let's take a quick break. I want to ask you about George Conway's idea. Much more in just a moment here on Reliable Sources.
Okay.
We are back on Reliable Sources, and we're back with Anthony Scaramucci, talking about all sorts of things. But I was struck by, of course, this week's other big political news, non-Trump related. It's Michael Bloomberg thinking about getting into this Democratic race. There was a tweet that stood out to me from Kellyanne Conway's husband, George. He was replying to somebody from the Brookings Institution saying, Mike Bloomberg's first major campaign move should be to buy Fox News. And Conway said, seriously, that would be the greatest thing he could do for the country. The idea being, I think, if you changed the content on Fox News, moved it away from its pro-Trump bent, then it would change politics in this country.
So, I mean, it's a cute idea.
It's not going to happen.
I don't see the mayor doing that. But first of all, I applaud him coming into the race because he's a very accomplished guy, and he's a very practical guy. And I think he'll add a voice that's needed in the race. And so hopefully he comes in full-fledged. But as it relates to Fox News, I think their business model will shift after the 2020 election. It's not clear to me that they'll stay as the enterprise that they are. And in fact, if they're sold, that wouldn't come as a surprise either. But I think that the current business model, and particularly the punditry at night, I think that that's in the process of shifting.
Why would Fox be sold after the election?
I think when you listen to their Lachlan Murdoch, you listen to some of the interviews, it may or may not be part of their long-term core strategy. But I get the sense that it may not be. And so we'll have to see what happens. Now, this is speculation to me as a money manager looking at their core assets, how they could actualize long-term value. I think the system that was set up by Roger Ailes and the way Fox News is produced in prime time, I think the expiration date of that is coming. And so my prediction is after the 2020 election, you'll probably see different levels of punditry there.
Interesting. You know, you were, of course, in the White House, in the press shop. Now Stephanie Grisham is press secretary. Let's put on screen just kind of a funny graphic how many times she's been holding press briefings at the White House podium versus the number of times she's been on Fox News. The numbers speak for themselves. You were joking with me. You actually beat her by this ranking.
Well, no, I mean, she's lasted like, I don't know, 40 or 50 mooches. Mooches being defined by 11-day periods of time. But
right.
I'm 1-0, but I
because you had one time at the podium.
Well, I had one time at the podium, but I understand what's going on there, unfortunately for her. And I like Stephanie. I know her a long time. She can't, you know, he's the sun king in many ways. There's only one spotlight in the Trump administration, and that's on the president. There can be no co-stars. There can be no disruption of that sort of activity. All press relates back to him. One of the biggest problems that America has is he's searching his name, Trump, as opposed to USA.
But, you know, Stephanie's
not going to be on anytime soon. That's another prediction.
I don't think so. We do try to book her every week, though. All right, quick break. More Reliable Sources in just a moment.